evening, everybody. My name is David Sproles, and I'm the president of the New York School of Interior Design, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to this evening's lecture called The Well-Dressed Window, a panel discussion on Henry Francis DuPont and his role as one of the early leaders of American decoration and how his extraordinary taste and eye transformed interior design today. Tonight, we are fortunate to have AD 100 designer Thomas Jane join Winterthur Design Associates principal designer Sandy Brown in celebrating her new book, The Well-Dressed Window, Curtains at Winterthur. For the past 25 years, Thomas Jane, founder of Jane Design Studio, has designed rooms that reflect a strong connection to history and place. Trained in American material culture and the decorative arts at Winterthur, Thomas earned his master's degree from the University of Delaware and pursued advanced fellowships at the American Wing of the Metropolitan Museum of Art, Historic Deerfield, and the J. Paul Getty Museum. In addition to his well-regarded design practice, Thomas is a noted author who writes frequently on historical themes in art, architecture, and decoration. He has written two books, published by the Monticelli Press, The Finest Rooms in America, and a monograph of his own work, American Decoration. Sandy, a resident of the Main Line, award-winning designer Sandy Brown, came to Winterthur Design in 2006, following positions with several distinguished firms in the Philadelphia area. She was recently honored for her work by the Southeastern Pennsylvania chapter of the American Society of Interior Designers. She holds a master's degree in interior architecture and design from the College of Media Arts and Design at Drexel University. Copies of the Well-Dressed Window Curtains at Winterthur will be available for purchase after the lecture, and I believe the two of you have agreed to sign them. So without further ado, sit back and enjoy, and the podium platform is all yours. Welcome. Thanks.
Thank you, David. Thank you all so much for coming. I'm actually born and raised in New York, so it's always good to be back. For those of you who are not familiar with Winterthur, it's located in the Brandywine Valley, just outside Wilmington, Delaware. It's a museum of decorative arts, American decorative arts, with a collection of nearly 90,000 objects made and used in America between about 1640 and 1860. The collection is displayed in a 175-room house, much as it was when the DuPont family lived there. It opened as a museum in 1951, and it's set in 1,000 acres of gardens, meadows, and woodlands. It has graduate programs and a preeminent research library that make it an important center for the study of American art and culture. I became enamored with Mr. DuPont's curtains many years ago when, as a graduate student in design, I attended a course at Winterthur. I was fascinated by the sheer beauty of the perfectly appointed curtains in the rooms. While the instructors were talking about furniture, I was sketching the curtains. Years later, as a designer specifying curtains for clients, I considered HF, Henry Francis DuPont, a master of curtain making and wanted to understand more about why he selected the textiles he did, the history of the fabrics, and where his ideas for the designs originated. This is how I came to research and write The Well-Dressed Window. I'll begin with a brief background on DuPont and how, as a designer, aesthetics played an important role in the presentation of his collection. And let me get this on the screen here. And then I've selected several rooms that go into more detail about the curtains, past seasonal changes, and DuPont's inspiration for the design. Henry Francis DuPont was a gentleman, a collector, a horticulturist, and a dairy farmer. He never referred to himself as an interior designer, yet today he's recognized as one of the great collectors and historians of American decorative arts. As one of the country's early interior designers, he was a contemporary of Nancy Lancaster, Dorothy Draper, Ruby Ross Wood, and her protege, Billy Baldwin, Van Dyke Truess, Eleanor Brown of Macmillan & Co., and Nancy McClellan. All but Nancy Lancaster, because she lived in England at the time, visited Winitor, followed by letters of appreciation and rave reviews. Nancy McClellan was president of the newly founded American Institute of Decorators, now the American Society of Interior Design, when HF was awarded honorary membership. 5 years before his death, he was presented with the Thomas Jefferson Award that you see here by the National Society of Interior Design for his extensive collection and for his restoration work at the White House. 2 years later, the New York chapter of ASID honored DuPont with its annual L.C. DeWolf Award for outstanding contribution in the field of design. It was as a designer rather than a collector that DuPont felt the greatest pride. HF's initial inspiration for creating an American house at Winitor resulted from a series of events in the early 1920s that included a visit to Shelburne Farms in Vermont to visit his friends, the Webbs, and observe their dairy cow breeding operation. His visual eye and passion for objects of beauty is apparent as he reflects on the trip in his own words. "We were staying at the home of Mrs. Webb. I hadn't thought anything of American furniture at all. I went upstairs, saw this pine dresser full of pink china, and I thought it charming, quite lovely. It just took my breath away." He and his wife, Ruth Wales DuPont, then went on to visit Beauport, the summer home of Henry Davis Sleeper in Gloucester, Massachusetts, which HF thought very attractively arranged. The experience was enlightening for DuPont and served to clarify his direction and focus his collecting efforts. HF was intrigued by the work of Sleeper, a Boston-based interior decorator who created colorful rooms using historic architecture as a backdrop for his collection of Americana. He had an impressive clientele at the time that included Isabella Stewart Gardner and Hollywood actors Joan Crawford and Frederick March. Sleeper's work would be a key influence on DuPont. Decorative elements that you see here, such as the backlit glass, the massing of objects, color as an organizing principle, Zubair wallpaper, and Tiger Makeboat furniture, can all be found at Winitor. Like many other collectors in the early 20th century, HF was strongly influenced by the period rooms at the American Wing at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, which opened in 1924. DuPont returned home from his trip determined to build his own American house, which he did, in the form of a grand summer residence in Southampton, Long Island. He named it Chestertown, as several of the rooms had architectural elements from 18th century houses found in Chestertown, Maryland. His vision for collecting Americana was still a bit radical at the time, when most Gilded Age socialites preferred European antiques. And this is the view of the house looking at the sea. Having engaged Sleeper to help him, he decorated it with American furnishings, quilts, canopy beds, hooked rugs, and antique chintz. These colorful accents were very much in the colonial revival spirit, or a romanticized interpretation of the past. Favorite elements of the Chestertown rooms were brought to Winitor in later years. The border at the top of the sitting room was very important to DuPont and came to be known as the pen hangings. Comprised of sections of 18th century crewel work, the embroidered cloth, as told through oral history, was believed to have come from the family of William Penn. And here you see a close-up of the pattern showing pastoral scenes of shepherds with their flocks and hunters with their dogs chasing rabbits. And it's still very vibrant in color today. Prized by DuPont for their beauty and provenance, he has them made into curtains and bed hangings for use in his own bedroom at Winitor in the picture that you see on the left. He later moves them to the Patuxent Room, where they drape the bed as a perfect complement to the green brocatel hanging at the windows against the warm gray painted woodwork. A short time after Chestertown was completed, DuPont inherited his ancestral home upon the death of his father and turned his attention to Winitowoc. And in the front, you can see the original 1839 part of the house, which was expanded and renovated by his father in 1903. And then this back part through the trees that you see here was the extension that DuPont added in order to house his amassing collection. Motivated by the idea of using historic architecture as a backdrop for his collection, DuPont began arranging attractive room settings in the spirit of those rooms that had so captivated him at Beauport. It was his intention to preserve evidences of the past through his arrangement of beautiful furnishings. Even as he was building his collections and installing period rooms, DuPont was both creating a home for his family and a home to entertain his many guests. While some of the room installations today show the collaboration of curators and educators, the Winitowoc collection was largely the result of the vision and talent of one man, blessed with a remarkable visual memory and inherently fine taste, and a touch of perfectionism. Well, maybe more than a touch. This is the golden white room at Winitowoc. In addition to his vast array of antique furnishings, H.F. had a passion for textiles and collected them in large quantity. To DuPont, the textiles in his rooms were as equally as important as the furniture. In the early 1940s, he writes to a friend, "I feel very strongly that the curtains, bed hangings, etc., will make all the difference in the house, even more than any pieces of furniture that you put into it." Henry Francis DuPont. He had a wonderful eye for proportion and detail, as well as an extraordinary sense of color. He often noted color as the thing that really counts more than any other. It was through his choice of textiles that he introduced color, texture, and pattern. Although the design of DuPont's window treatments evoked the period of the architectural elements in a particular room, the fabrics themselves had little relation to what was actually in use in America in the 18th and 19th centuries. The dealers DuPont patronized obtained a majority of their stock in Europe, where vast quantities of antique fabrics were readily available from estates, churches, and personal collections of dresses, bed covers, and other furnishing fabrics. In fact, many, if not most, of the textiles used to furnish Winitowoc did not cross the Atlantic until the early 20th century. Decorating a 175-room house is quite an undertaking, and HF originally gauged Sleeper to assist him. However, Sleeper was unable to devote the necessary hours to the project. Determined to proceed, HF sought out museum curators as well as other collectors and dealers to consult and assist. He corresponded with Joseph Downs when he was curator at the Philadelphia Museum. Their letters and visits continued when Downs became curator at the American Wing at the Met. Downs had also authored several articles regarding the recreation of authentic historic window and bed hangings. Downs was later recruited as the first Winitowoc curator. Bertha Bancart, a family friend, collector, and lady with exquisite taste, became his right-hand person with regard to selections and decisions. For 17 years, they spent countless hours discussing the right balance, the right fold, and the perfect paint color. H.F. greatly admired the taste of the of Downs and Bancard, both of whom had their homes published in Helen Comstock's book, 100 Most Beautiful Rooms in America, along with selected rooms from Winitor. About Downs, he wrote, "I have thought of Joe's house as one of the gems of all old houses I know." After Bertha's death, Mrs. DuPont wrote to a relative, "She has been his friend for over 50 years. It was Bertha's advice on textiles and colors HF prized above all others." However, it was DuPont himself who ultimately selected each antique textile, tassel, fringe, and braid. He spent an infinite number of hours looking at paintings, engravings, and books to find the correct representation for the architecture of each room. But at the end of the day, for DuPont, aesthetics always trumped historic accuracy. While Joe Downs is still curator at the Met, H.F. writes, "Dear Bertha, Joe Downs has come and gone. Joe thinks that the blue of the New York room is too late a color for the room. He suggests a pumpkin or a deep gray, but I am not paying the slightest attention to that thought. In my opinion, the room looks extremely well just the way it is. Sincerely, H.F. DuPont." It was the firm of Ernest Lonanno Interiors, a curtain and upholstery workroom based in New York City, that worked closely with HF to fabricate a great many of the curtains at Winitor. They spent countless hours refining the details, making templates of the pelmets and valances until they got it just right. While Lonanno's skills were in demand by many of the distinguished museums at the time, including the Met, the Philadelphia Museum of Art, and Williamsburg, Winitor was by far his largest commission. This is an image of the back of two curtain panels in our curtain storage. DuPont was an impressive record keeper. Most textiles were marked with sewn-on labels that identified the particular season they were to be hung, with season one being the months January through March, season two, April to June, and so on. The labels were primarily to instruct the staff so there would be no mistake as to which curtains hung where and when. Of course, with changes in installations over the years and with new labels being added, deciphering which labels belong to which time period can be a bit of a puzzle for our curators today. The importance of color in the Winitor garden played an essential part in the choice of the seasonal interior color schemes. The inside-out connection was an important one for DuPont, and textiles brought nature's colors indoors. In HF's day, it was customary household practice among both the middle and the upper classes to change the look of a room with seasonal curtains and slipcovers. Changes over the years were also dictated by DuPont's prolific acquisition of new furniture and fabrics, which, of course, he wanted to highlight. These changes resulted in hundreds of sets of curtains in the collection, now housed in curtain storage. And there is a picture of curtain storage, one of the rooms of curtain storage, of which there are at least five. And you can request a special tour if you're ever visiting Winitor to go and view the curtain storage. The Baltimore drawing room, known as the morning room when the DuPont family was in residence, is arranged with furnishings that might have graced a refined drawing room in a Baltimore townhouse. While the furnishings and decorative elements are primarily American, the curtain fabric is French. The silk lampis is a reproduction of the pattern and color of silk bed hangings that, according to family tradition, came to America in 1800 with HF's great-great-grandfather, Pierre Samuel DuPont. Prell, a silk manufacturing company established in Lyon in 1752 and still in business today, with a showroom in New York, actually, was commissioned to reproduce 170 yards of the silk for Winitor. While the pattern was found in the Prell archives, Winitor sent a well-preserved scrap of the original to ensure the color was copied perfectly. DuPont, of course, knew the antique textiles would become increasingly fragile and would have to be replaced. DuPont had these stereo views of the rooms taken in 1935 and 1938, and they offer us important documentation of early installations and provide a visual record of DuPont's original intent. And for those of you not familiar with the stereo view, it was a photography technique popular up until about World War II. The photos were taken with a double-lens camera in black and white and then hand-colored. And then when you viewed them through a special stereo viewer, they appeared three-dimensional. The original curtain fabric that you see here on the right was a 19th century silk brocade, probably French, in a similar color scheme. The pink and yellow stripes have faded. The design of the valance used all year round in the room today is copied from this original set. The valance and curtain panels, which replicate the style of the 1930 set that we just saw, were made shortly after HF's death. They're trimmed with modern silk fringe from Clarence House, and the antique tassels from the 1930 set have been reused on this valance. DuPont's design for the valance may have been adapted from this Austrian shade pattern published in a Parisian interior design periodical in 1860. We don't always know what his design inspirations were. They weren't always written down. And all the templates went to Lonanno in New York City, and unfortunately, they did not survive. DuPont worked with Joe Downs after Downs came to Winitor to design this valance made from a late 19th century silk lampas. This set was a seasonal change for spring and summer, made in the 1950s. The fringe and tassel cording featuring these small knots at the top and the ends are fine decorative details that we often overlook in today's decor. And there's a close-up of the antique tassel. And the pattern is a directoire design that was fashionable in France in about 1800. And this is the Wentworth room. The woodwork in the Wentworth room was purchased from the Board of Trustees at the Met, who offered to sell DuPont this second floor bedchamber from a house built by John Wentworth in New Hampshire about 1695. It became the setting for DuPont's prized collection of furnishings from the early Baroque period. I just love how this lively fabric brightens up this low-ceilinged, wooded room. The curtain and upholstery fabric, now used all year round, was designed and made by Brunswick and Fee. The fabric is based on a hand-blocked French Indienne textile that was first designed and printed at the Oberkampf factory in Jouy, France, in the late 18th century in similar bright colors. Winitor has a sample of the original textile in the collection. Designed and made in our Winitor sewing room, the valance is trimmed with red cotton tape and patterned after this 18th century bed valance. The original piece is in the collection of the Peabody Essex Museum, who acquired it from a Massachusetts family. DuPont acquired this set of early 18th century curtains from the New York City firm French & Company. The fabric is cotton, embroidered in silk, in a technique known as tambour work, possibly made in India for the British export market. During his lifetime, DuPont used these all year round in this room. He wrote the dealer who had purchased the curtains in London and inquired as to the provenance of the curtains. A representative of the company replied, "The curtains came from Keir Park, a country estate in Worcestershire, England, seat of the Pitts family from the late 16th century to the early 20th century. The curtains were purchased when the contents of the estate were sold." And these are unusual because they were bought as curtains. He did have them refurbished to fit, and he obviously had a little bit of extra fabric because he had the wing chair reupholstered in it also. You can note the very finely executed chain stitch. If you ever do take the tour of the curtain storage, you can see these, and you can see how minuscule each chain stitch is. And there's a close-up of it. The McIntyre Room is named in honor of Samuel McIntyre, the noted architect and master woodcarver from Salem, Massachusetts. The South Room, as it was formerly known, was the guest bedroom used by Bertha Bancourt during her many visits to Winitor. Sun streams in the windows, and the extraordinary Grecian sofa placed on an angle is the focal point of the room. The color scheme featuring bright yellow satin embroidered with a fleur-de-lis pattern, mauve accents, and soft gray walls has been in use consistently since the 1930s. Shown in 1938 in one of the stereo views, the 19th century silk satin curtains were used in spring. And note here the original French style casement windows. Almost all the original windows were replaced with double hung or American style windows in the 1940s room. DuPont has curtain valances to match that bed valance, but he can't use it with the casement windows. So here it is, photographed in 1947, and you can see now he has the windows replaced and he can use his added valances that match the bed valance. Also note the early 19th century fleur-de-lis pattern on the upholstery. You can see that here. And the curtains in the room that you saw today are based on this pattern, on the satin. This photograph shows the seasonal change for the room for the summer. Cascades and cotton mull, made in India for the British export market, are paired with an early 19th century hand-painted cornice. The curtain panels were cut from one large piece of cloth, probably a bed cover, which accounts for their unusual shape, something curators would never do today. And here's a close-up of the cornice. The cornice complements the neoclassical decoration and supports the gathered valance, delicately embroidered with silver threads and trimmed with a crocheted border. The border used for the valances and to trim the curtains was cut off the edge of the original piece. To complement the mull, DuPont used a copper plate-printed cotton, originally deep purple, now sadly faded to brown, to dress the bed and slipcover the furniture. The pattern featuring female figures from Greek mythology was designed by Parisian artist Jean-Baptiste Huet and printed in Jouy, France, about 1808. DuPont purchased the textiles and tassels, which are made from silver metallic threads from Ernest Lonanno, and the curtains were also sewn by him in the 40s. This is a present-day view of the other end of the McIntyre bedroom, and the fabric for a set of curtains that match the embroidered silk satin bed hanging shown on the bed today was also purchased from and sewn by Lonanno. And here you see them in a black and white photograph. The curtains are made from the same silk as the bedside curtain that you see here on the right. Large wooden spool tassels painted gray hang from the shaped valance and complement the color scheme. In the view of the bedside curtain, we can see the silk-embroidered fleur-de-lis design. It appears to have been painted with a watery dye or paint that creates an aura of bright gold, and you can see that at the top there. And also over here, you see very old wisteria growing outside the window. So when it was in bloom, it would have been in the purple, which is possibly the reason for his color scheme here. HF's attention to detail is evident in this letter to Lomano. He's referring to these gold curtains. I'm returning the south room valance. It should be more curved, and it looks too skimpy as is. On the new one, please put black lining, as the effect is otherwise hard to see. The blue room, probably one of my most favorite rooms at Winitor. With its large, four large windows looking out on the grounds, the blue room, once the bedroom of Ruth Wells DuPont, affords a breathtaking view of the surrounding garden. The mantelpiece, carved with neoclassical designs, sets the tone for the overall decoration. The pale blue-green wash on the walls, in contrast with the subtle shade of red in the textiles, both enlivens the room yet leaves it restful. The valances may have been inspired by a Thomas Sheraton pattern book. Mrs. DuPont always preferred the French casement windows and requested that they remain, which they do today. Late 18th century linen, probably French, used all year round today, was the summer seasonal change. The floral pattern is printed using carved blocks, which allows the undyed part of the fabric to remain. The original sheer hand-embroidered mull was probably early 20th century. It was eventually replaced with a scalamandre embroidered sheer. HF loved these embroidered mulls that were originally made in India and then Europe. He used them to create a soft, airy effect in many of the Winitor rooms in summer. The mahogany cornice is inlaid with ebony and satin wood, and these curtains and slipcovers were also made by Lonanno. Here's another stereo view showing the spring installation in the 1930s. White silk damask is used for the curtains, trimmed with a pale blue ribbon purchased from New York City dealer Josephine Howell. Subtle yet colorful, the raspberry color of the rug enlivens the pale blue of the in the textiles. And we can see this bed hanging up here, and here is a close-up of it. It's an 18th century woven silk and trimmed with an abundance of tassel fringe. This was one of our reproduction fabrics, of which there have been many over the years. A set of cream damask curtains were made in the 1970s in the style of the original, and the ribbon from the original was preserved and sewn on to these new replacement sets. And this French silk barrette, probably late 18th century or early 19th century, was used for the winter seasonal change. After the family moved to the cottage across the way, when the house became a museum, every available space became a room for display. The Latimeria room was just a closet adjacent to the Port Royal parlor, which was the major reception room or living room when Winitor was the DuPont family home. And you can see how small this room is. Here's the door to the closet. So it's tiny, tiny. He installed a window and shelving he acquired from Mary Latimer's house in Wilmington before it was demolished. Colorful silk taffeta curtains hang to the floor from a painted wood cornice. The early 19th century silk, probably made in France or England, is light in weight and seamed in multiple places, suggesting it may have been once used as a dress fabric. DuPont used this late 18th century silk satin, hand-painted with vignettes of Chinese life, for the valance and curtain panels for the spring and fall. Limited yardage of this beautiful piece may have also contributed to the shallow, scalloped shape of the valance. The challenge in working with antique fabrics is that often there's not enough fabric to make curtains, and creativity is required when sewing them. In this case, a piece of embroidered silk was found to widen the panel, which is the blue on the right here. The embroidery had to be unpicked and then hand-painted to match. So can you imagine these beautiful, gorgeous curtains in that little closet? That was Mr. DuPont. The Marlborough Room. The wood paneling in the Marlborough Room was acquired by DuPont from Patuxent Manor, a plantation house built in Lower Marlborough, Maryland, in the mid-18th century. In spite of its imposing proportions, the warm, earthy colors, leather furnishings, and easy chairs arranged in multiple conversation areas make this a relaxed yet sophisticated space. Textures, pattern, and color come together beautifully here. Today, the curtains are fashioned from cotton printed with a chinoiserie design that replicates a fabric DuPont used in the early 30s. Faithfully fabricated in the same style, they were made in the Winitore sewing room. The original fabric was block printed in England about 1805 in Pompeian colors, a distinct combination of red, brown, and yellow, found on Pompeian frescoes discovered in the 18th century. The reproduction fabric is shown in contrast to the original, with the brighter colors reflecting the original textile before fading. And the reason we know this is the curators could turn back the selvage where it had not faded, and they can see the original coloring. Shown here in summer, these curtains hung in the Marlborough Room for more than 60 years until they became increasingly fragile and had to be replaced. DuPont labored over the pelmet design, corresponding back and forth with Bertha Bancard for months. They were concerned about, they were both concerned about hiding the charming print in too many folds. HF finally decides to take a design element from the fabric, using part of the pagoda roof as the template for the pelmet. So he eventually just decides to take that shape, and that becomes the pelmet. This autochrome slide shows how the room appeared before DuPont inherited the house. The family called it the Red Room for decades due to the red silk and linen brocatelle upholstering the walls that you see here on the right. The stereo view shows the curtains DuPont had made from the former wall upholstery on the left. The bed valance in William Hogarth's painting, which is a satirical portrayal of fashionable life, may have been DuPont's inspiration for the pelmet. DuPont, Bankard, and Downs were known to look to Hogarth paintings and engravings as a source for design elements of the period, especially curtains. And you see the bed valance up here would have been used as a design for the pelmets over there. And this painting hangs in the National Gallery in London. And here's a close-up of the brocatelle, which is believed to be 18th century. And the pelmet still hangs on the wall in curtain storage. Continuing the tradition of using red textiles in the Marlborough Room, Winitore curators had the War Maureen reproduced for Winitour in France just after DuPont's death. The Marlborough Room continues to exhibit a seasonal change with the red curtains used in fall and winter and the chinoiserie used in spring and summer. And there's one more room that we still do seasonal changes, and that's the Chinese Parlor. Now remember this view of this room because you're going to see it later, decorated by Thomas Jane. This 18th century English wool moreen, shown left as a seat cover from our Winitour collection, was used as an example to reproduce the modern fabric. This yellow silk set of curtains was made to replace the red brocatel that was being retired, and the shape of the helmet was copied from this Hogarth engraving. While in the process of designing these curtains, H.F. writes, this was in the 40s, "Dear Bertha, there is no question that the extra curve is prettier in the Hogarth print. If we cover the window trim with the valance, as I wrote to you yesterday, sketch of which I sent to Lonano, do you think those ears will look all right projecting over the wall panel? How can I get a photograph of the large Hogarth print?" He was very anxious to get these curtains made, writing to Bertha Bancourt daily. So the shape of the helmet is adapted from that same Hogarth engraving that was used for the yellow set. And the design of the gold satin trim is patterned after the trim on this 18th century bed valance found in the Winitour collection. And that's where the design came from. And there it is in the curtain storage. Miles Red designed this colorful bedroom, selecting a modern interpretation of a chinoiserie helmet for the window. The house was published in Elle Decor in 2010. The great decorator, Sister Parish, of Parish Hadley fame, said, "In good decoration, innovation is often the ability to reach into the past and bring back what is good, what is useful, and what is lasting." So these historic references that inspired DuPont are still very much relevant today. And that brings us to the next part of our program, where Thomas Jane is going to talk about the present. So let me tell a little bit more about Thomas. He's known as a scholar decorator. He's become renowned for his deep knowledge of the history of design and for creating new and refreshing spaces for modern day life. In other words, traditional decor for modern people. His impeccable credentials, graduate study at Winitour, the Met, working at Christie's, and for the legendary Albert Hadley at the firm Parish Hadley, have never dictated his style as fussy. He has a seemingly effortless ability to make a lacquered Parsons table work with antique Queen Anne-style chairs in a contemporary interior. He designs for real life, but an elegant version of it. In addition to his other accolades, Jane Design Studio recently received the prestigious Stanford White Award for the decoration of rooms at Critchell House, a 1770 country house in Dorset, England, designed by the neoclassical architect James White. His third book, due out soon, is a homage to Edith Wharton and Ogden Codman's Bible of Interior Design, The Decoration of Houses. Thomas has been a great friend to Winitour over the years, graciously acting as keynote speaker at the Winitour-sponsored Delaware Antique Show, consulting on various projects on the Winitour estate, and reinterpreting H.F. DuPont's Marlborough Room for the 21st century. He's also been a great mentor to me. And there you see it. Thomas was asked to decorate the Marlborough Room for our Yuletide tour. So there you see the red curtains that we just looked at and his combining the antique chairs and antique furniture with contemporary chairs in a Brunswick and Fee fabric. There's another view of another sitting area and contemporary art. This was quite avant-garde at the time at the museum, and only Thomas Jane could make it work. So I will turn it over to you, Thomas.
Thomas Jane, it's curtains. So I had the privilege of working at Parrish Hadley, and Mrs. Parrish and I had one decorating interface, and that was that she asked me to go shopping for her curtains for her library and her masonette up the street. And I came back, I was very earnest. And first of all, her whole office was a setup because the chairs are really small and low. So I was just totally ill-fitting in her office. And she was, of course, sitting higher than me, and I was looking up at her, and I was showing her various samples, and I had recommended that she have beautiful green curtains with pink and blue fringe. And she said, pink and blue fringe on green curtains? I go, yes, Mrs. Parrish, it's very mannerist. And she just said, what do you mean? But working at Parrish Hadley and also at being at Winterthur really started my thinking about curtains. As I say in the introduction to the book, they can either be prosaic or fantastic. You can have the most simple sheet on a window, or you can have just yards and yards of silk and beautiful, elaborate passementerie. But I think that every decorator who really thinks about it is, do you need curtains? Why have curtains? What will the curtains do? And really, as Edith Wharton said, you know, if you have great architecture, you don't really need them. And that is always the best solution, to have a room that's architecturally strong. And if you do use curtains, it's just an adjunct. But if you have to have curtains, there's a mistake. And today, as most of you out there that are decorators or are interested in design, most of us are presented with rooms without architecture. They're just white boxes. And therefore, curtains become extremely important. Even sheer curtains. A lot of times, the walls are all windows, and your only defense is sort of to imply architecture by making sheer panels, just straight white panels of cloth on hospital tracks. So it is always a question. Does this room need curtains, and how will they make them better? In the Edith Wharton and Ogden Codman also wrote that anything after the French Revolution was debased, and therefore of no value. And that's also the time when curtains became much more valuable, much more apparent, because fabric got less expensive, and it could be used more abundantly. And I really argue that I think the designers love the change of material from from wood or stucco paneling to the softness of fabric. It's one of the natural contrasts in good design. As all of you know, contrast is core to any great design, and fabric, the softness of fabric, in a hard room can be so transportive. So my first commission was working for Tom Savage. He's now a director at Winterthur Museum. And he asked me to work on his Charleston apartment. And we started faxing back and forth. That was how long ago it was. And our editor at House Beautiful said it was like a parlor game. We would send back and forth designs. And finally, we hit upon the idea of imitating Mr. DuPont's curtains in the DuPont dining room that he had patterned after Sheraton. So here's the room as it stands today. And then here's the plate from Sheraton. And forgive this next slide because it was made in 1990. Here's Tom Savage's apartment. And you can see a very contemporary and modestly priced imitation of the idea that Sheraton had conveyed of the pelmets with the zigzags. And this room was also a white box. It had been renovated, it was white drywall, and the curtains added a lot of architectural dimension, as did the decorative painting that Tom actually executed himself. I like to take historical models and imitate them for contemporary use, and I guess I got that idea from Mr. DuPont, and also the scholars that came after him, who were all deeply interested in looking at historic sources. It was really only in the 80s that we decided that curtains had some sort of cultural import. Before then, they were really just decorations and not something we could learn from. But this is a 19th century view of a room probably in Russia. And then this is me suggesting that we make curtains that match. We're doing the mock-up and plastic drop cloths. And this is the net result. But you can see that they're not 19th century and they look contemporary, but we did something really risky and we made swags and jabots, because basically most people don't make elaborate valances or pelmets today. It's just a straight pull. And so my colleague William Cullen and I said, let's take a risk and try to do beautiful pelmets. It did drive me up a ladder to arrange them in plastic, because the curtain room was just flummoxed by the idea of doing this design. But I think in the end they did a very beautiful job. And another view of the room. And interesting, there are two types of windows which demanded two types of curtains. And we have this very dramatic theatrical pair of panels made of Indian silk, which showcases one of our client's sculptures. And I like the play of her, the little baldachin is actually carved of wood, and then we have cloth curtains flanking it. And here's another view of it. And the really great thing is the lining. They're lined with fabric printed with birds. So that it's beautiful fabric on the outside, is just a printed Indian border, but the bonus item is behind it. And this is another historical model that we found in a 19th century design book. And this is their manifestation in about 5 years ago. And we were able to copy the swags and jabots and also the window shade. We painted the blind to match the print. So you can see the window shade in the print source. And this is the execution. And this was made for a woman in her 60s who had been deeply tutored by Mr. DuPont's generation. She just loved the 20th century take on 19th century design. And so it was pretty much a throwback to be asked to do this commission. I realized I was kind of being brought out of retirement to revive DuPontian high style. And this is the view of the whole room with the Duncan Five furniture, some of which we recreated and some is original, and a superlative picture collection of American paintings. Very beautiful collection, from Sargent to Chase to all the most important painters. And the curtains almost seem reticent in the setting in the collection, which I think is pretty great. And also the enhancement of the architecture, meaning the architecture supports the curtains. And I think here it's a good wedding. I like to say in meetings with architects to give them confidence that architecture is the mother of the arts, and that I'm not going to mess up your rooms with bad decoration. And I think this is a great combination. And then the library is much more informal in the house, and I did this continuous valance, which is sort of a 1930s style thing to do, but it starts from one end of the room to the other and pulls back. And then the antifixes that were in the plaster frieze we had cast for the curtain holdbacks. And another print source from the 18th century, a design for a border. And then the curtains that we were able to make by applicating felt and then over embroidering. And here they are in the room in Southampton. And, you know, Southampton's a beach town, but it's also a place where you put on black dresses for cocktails in the evening. So these are two dressy rooms. And then finally, the use of just plain white curtains in the most contemporary way. A room on the main line for collectors of American pictures. I mean, a post-20th century, post-war art. These paintings were by Richter. And it actually has five or six shades of different colors, but it's just that calm whiteness that sometimes plain curtains are the right thing. And then another set of plain curtains with walls covered in aesthetic movement wallpaper. So sometimes you hold back. And a wonderful room in Oyster Bay, again, where we just use shears, partly out of function and partly out of architecture. And I conclude with this recent notice in the Wall Street Journal for our forthcoming book. We covered one room with gold spider webs in connection with a painting. And the editor called up and was quizzing us about the room, about why did you put gold spider webs on the room, because the clients had a painting with a tarantula and spider webs, and we just thought it'd be witty to use it as a wall decoration. And she said, why does the bed have shower curtains on it? I said, it's just a contemporary play of elaborate and simple. Here's the painting. And then there's spider webs. And there are the dead plane curtains. So it is a balancing act. So I leave you with the idea that, you know, curtains can have a purpose. They can be elaborate or simple, but they are one of the most useful tools in decoration for changing decor. And they have a long and wonderful history that is great to tap into. They don't just have to be straight panels, but sometimes straight panels are the right thing. And I think Mr. DuPont would be so proud and honored that you are all here today to celebrate his legacy. So do we have to take hard questions? Should we just use the microphone?
If you want to go over to the platform, you're welcome to the bed.
Is it electrified? Okay.
I can feel like I'm a big cat.
She has a question.
I noticed that a lot of the curtains were off the floor. Was that purposeful, or was that because they shrunk because the heat in the house shrunk?
At Winitor? Yes, a lot of times they have been refurbished, conserved. Sometimes they've had to take pieces from the top, so it shortens the length a little bit.
I think it was the taste, too. I think Mr. DuPont had a very streamlined taste that was sort of 1930s. And so sometimes it's economy of fabric, but sometimes it's just the taste. Because you look at contemporary decorating books, they're those strip-like valances, and it's not touching the floor.
They are.
But it's a kind of a...
It's a combination.
Curtains and lampshades are really predicated by international style of the moment, I think. Anyway, sometimes it's purposeful. We tend to put an inch break on curtains on the floor unless we're really whacking it out, but it's pretty out of style to have more than an inch or so breaking. It's like pants cuffs.
Yeah. Changes with the style.
Yes.
Yeah. But they do tend to hang off the floor, which bothers me a great deal.
When they're off the floor?
When they're a little bit too much off the floor.
Well, I noticed a lot of the paint in a lot of the photographs, they were off the floor like 2 inches. And I know in certain older homes, when the heat is really hot, it can shrink the fabric.
Sure.
And I didn't know if that was, if that happened there on purpose, or that was a style.
So, Sometimes it's the humidity.
Yeah.
I think it's a combo.
And I've also been in homes where in the winter they're off the floor, and in the summer when the heat's not on, they're relaxed and they grow.
Touch right, yeah.
Yeah.
It's a dilemma.
Yes.
I just beg people not to clean their curtains and to vacuum them on a low suction vacuum as long as possible, because it's pretty much, I've never seen curtains really clean successfully. So it's almost like you use them until you have to replace them, which I know sounds cavalier because you can't make a set of curtains for less than thousands of dollars now, but that's what I did want to say. Winterthur, they send them to the dry cleaner all the time, right?
Well, they send them to conservation. They might be there for years, carefully removing some of the grime and the dirt. So it's a very, very involved process there.
When I decorated the Winterthur for Christmas, I sent all the decorations down, and they froze them for 2 weeks. They put them in this big freezer so that all the bugs would die. And I just felt like that was the apogee to have everything deep freeze.
Yes, that is the process. Yes. We haven't done it for a while. It was in the 70s and 80s. It was very popular. We were doing it quite a bit. So I think the time will come very soon. So we have not yet.
There was a connoisseur moment, though, because they figured out they could silkscreen the patterns, and to their eye it looked equivalent, and then they didn't age right. And now they realize that they really have to reproduce it using all the traditional methods, and that's deeply expensive. Furthermore, the workrooms that used to be able to reproduce them, there's few left.
There's very few in Italy. And
especially printed fabrics.
It's prohibitively expensive.
Yeah.
But we have improvements in the HVAC system and the lighting and all that, so things last longer. Yes? Yes, no, it is alive and well. Curtains interlined, lined, weighted, you can still specify that. That's not very popular. In fact, never do it. I may do a shaped, I'll go into the museum and maybe take a shaped from one of the a shaped palmet or something. But rarely ever do elaborate curtains. But if you notice, Mr. DuPont, even his pelmets and valances were quite simple in shape.
There's three or four workrooms in New York that can do it. But it's like making a dress. You know, you kind of have to know how to drape fabric. It's very hard to you have to do it all the time. It's not like you can step up and say, "Oh, I'm going to make swags." It's hard, and there's a total art to it, and you tend to, I'm not joking, we did make the first mock-up of plastic sheeting because I wanted to curve a certain way, and then we made one in fabric, and then we adjusted that, and then we made the real ones, and then I didn't like them for about 3 days while they moved them around. So it's a process. Not to be into lighting, but I think the rewards are really rich if you have the right setting, so I don't think there are no play. I think that more people should do them. And it's like any traditional craft. If there's more patronage, then more people will do it. So it gets easier.
just placed on, it was hard to tell the
Mr. Talk about Chestertown.
Go ahead. You've written about it. It's a long story.
Yeah, it's like a social diary Google search, but it was bought by several owners and really defaced and then ultimately torn down.
Oh.
It was a great loss because what's there is not pretty. And what was the other question?
Were they stone or were they...
It's all artifice. It's supposed to look like... That's the whole genius. You're supposed to... That's another discussion. But there's two things to talk about. First of all, the idea is when you're doing extraction to us, it's supposed to look continuous like it's one piece of fabric and, you know, done with great ease and relaxation. But usually there are multiple pieces that have been sandwiched, you know, that have been pieced together to give the appearance of that. But
and the bias cuts in between?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's highly organized sometimes. And, you know, all of us have tried to go buy a piece of Indian bedspread and put it on two nails and try to drape it, and you can kind of get the gist of how it's hard to make it look good. The other thing is the print sources were engraved and drawn, and they weren't usually real curtains, so you can, like, really try hard to imitate a design engraving, but you can't do it because it wasn't fabric, it was just a drawing. That's why it's more interesting, sometimes easier to imitate a painting of a room where you know at least probably they happened, as opposed to a print source where it was just someone having, you know, a fantasy of what curtains might look like. Jonathan Hogg asked that mean question.
I want to hear about your process from inspiration to communicating with your clients your ideas and sort of your drawings and these mock-ups and so forth. Is there a narrative involved with fabric selection, et cetera?
Well, it's a little like Mr. DuPont. And my life is a little like Mr. DuPont and Mrs. Bankhead, but faster. In the sense that, there's a lot of parallels. First of all, you're always looking around at things and thinking, oh, those are really interesting. I'd like to try those. It's not unlike architecture. Jonathan's an architect. And you see, like, a beautiful house, and you think that would be nice to incorporate. And then you get the given situation, and that's driven by the room and how much architecture the room has. And does it need curtains? And then what type of curtains? And a lot of times clients have anathema to curtains, so you have to convince them that they're the right thing. And if you're in that case, you might be fortunate just to get poles and rings. But if some sort of valance or pelment, or as they say in Texas, top treatment is demanded, then you try for those. And then that's a period of, you know, that's drawings and then mock-ups and then paper mock-ups, cloth mock-ups, and then the real deal. It's something I'm really glad I worked at Parrish Hadley and at Kevin McNamara's, because I got to make them with someone who made them all the time, and I keep the tradition alive, sort of just barely. Maybe once a year or twice a year we'll do elaborate curtains. So it's training and, you know, training and practice.
Same as Mr. DuPont, I love to use fabric on the windows. It brings in color, it softens, if there's a lot of wood in the room, it brings a softness. They can be light and airy, they don't have to be elaborate, they don't have to be damask. Fabric shades are also a nice solution sometimes.
It's basically driven by the location. And how much you can convince your clients they're interested in doing.
And the function of the room, how it's functioning. Sometimes they're just needed for privacy and light control. Simple as that.
Yeah.
I have a question for you, Thomas.
Yes, ma'am.
Your trims, do you have them made?
Yes. Well,
embroidered, or usually are you buying them ready-made? Some of the elaborate trims
those richly embroidered curtains were all made by a couture vendor who does embroidery for fashion. and the, a lot of the tape, almost all the tapes are custom, but not expensive. You just have to order them. They're the same price as going to the D&D and buying them. But then the elaborate Pasa Monterey, where that, there's very little that's available off the rack now. Even 10 years ago, there was more. So almost all that has to be made. So you can just use an embroidered ribbon, or if you want tassels, though, that means you have to make them, pretty much. Which makes sense, because not many people want tassels on their curtains at the moment. I charge all of you with reviving fringed curtains.
It started here, it started tonight, this is where it's going to begin, right?
Amen.
Well, thank you both. And I'm going to purchase the book of the Bag of the Home, get the rest of